Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to One Community Church. Would you stand with us as we worship our Lord and Savior? The greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Well, shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive, oh yeah.
Happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
When I stand in place, free and last, then face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. In this joy and perfect peace, with the pain I finally will cease to celebrate, Jesus is alive.
He's alive. My sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Never mind you change.
Oh, what a glorious way.
You have saved me.
Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious day.
Through the woods.
this all this feeling. If you listen, you pull out all, turn back to face. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say,
blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name, the sun shining down on me. The world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, there's pain in the offering.
Oh,
blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say,
oh,
blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Oh,
you give and take away, you give and take away. Choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name.
Oh, blessed
be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Oh, yeah, the name of the Lord.
Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
The only one that's worthy to be praised.
I'll tell you, it's. I often stand up here and like try to like think of something clever to say that's pertinent and relevant, but I'm most times just like almost overwhelmed by how great our God is. Like just standing in his house with fellow believers. Vaughn's sermons always get me fired up. We serve a great God, don't we? Yeah. And I think sometimes that loss of words can be blamed on the fact that, you know, God is so big, so vast, so far beyond our comprehension, that it just leaves us speechless. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, with all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow with everything I believe in. Now I surrender to you, Lord, Savior. He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine
your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
How about it for the risen King today?
Of your word. For in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray all these things. God were external. This is a continuation of dealing with faith. This is one of the benefits of faith, having eternal life. In the Gospels, it's easy to tell when Jesus really wants our attention. Or he wants you to focus and pay close attention to what he has to say. It's so important. And here, in both these verses, Jesus demonstrates this. In the Greek Bible, there's two ways the emphasis is shown. One way, a sentence or a statement. Maybe one way in our English Bible. But in the Greek Bible, when it's really, the Lord is really trying to get our attention, whatever that typically would be at the beginning of the sentence, or the end of the sentence in English, in the Greek Bible, it's up in the very front. The other way is by repetition. And we do this all the time with our husbands when they don't listen. You told me you were going to go to the grocery store. You told me you were going to go to the grocery store. You said you wouldn't say that to me again. You said you wouldn't say that to me again. But here, verse 24, Jesus says, very truly. And in the Greek Bible, it's literally pronounced, amen, amen. And in the English, it can be truly, truly. Or most certainly, or very truly. When we write love letters to our wives, and if you have many, now you start doing that like I did when I was a teenager. I read some of those letters, I thought it was smooth. But just at the end, I would even quit. I love you so much, very, very, very truly, I mean this. And Jesus is saying here, very truly, amen, amen. And here Jesus, in verse 24, our Lord is able to declare three great promises. Very truly, I tell you. It's really more powerful verb than I tell you. What Jesus is really saying here is that very truly, or most certainly, amen, amen, I declare to you. And what's the difference between telling somebody something and making a declaration? A declaration is a formal announcement. In order for us to say something, it's considered a declaration or a formal announcement. You have to have authority. You have to have power. If I call CNN today and I tell them, I'm having a press conference tomorrow at 11 o'clock, nobody will show up. Maybe some of y'all would, maybe, but I don't have enough authority. I don't have enough power for that announcement to be that big a deal to the whole world. But when Jesus says, most certainly, verily, verily, amen, amen, we need to pay attention. I'm going to use a little slang term here. When Jesus says that, he's about to drop the bomb. He's about to drop the mic. We need to pay attention because this is powerful when he has to say it's explosive. And he has three great promises. These three great promises have made the biggest change in all of our lives. From the moment we made that decision to eternity, the biggest change in all of our lives. Jesus goes on to say in verse 24, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but is crossed over from death to life. The reason why Jesus is qualified to make this declaration, this formal announcement, and he says this in verse 24, he's qualifying when he says this. This message is so powerful. And only Jesus can make this statement. make these three promises. No other person in the history of the world can make these three promises that Jesus made you. And Jesus says that my Father sent me. Now here in our English Bible, he says, who sent me? His Father sent Jesus from heaven to earth. Jesus must have thought it was really important for him to leave the glory of heaven to come here to earth and to fulfill these three promises that he makes here. And if you've ever read books regarding people dying and going to heaven, and when they come back, and I'm about to read one of those books now, and I've read one, no one, when they die and go to heaven, they have that out-of-body experience, then when they come back, they're upset. And I've talked to two people who've had that experience. One was a minister, pastor, he told me, he said, Bob, I do not want to come back. The peace that I felt, the love that I felt, and I saw people who had gone home before me. I didn't want to come back. And Lori had an uncle that had that experience. And Lori shared with me, I met Uncle Mark, God rest his soul, when I was 19. He was grumpy then. And Lori said that after he had that near-death experience and came back, he was never the same. He was so upset that he didn't stay in heaven. And Jesus left the glory of heaven to come to this wicked world because he loves us so much. And Jesus declared three promises to all of us who hear or obey. And it's word to everyone who believes God the Father who sent him. And the first great promise that Jesus made, you will all have or possess spiritual eternal life from the proper penalty of sin. And it's so important for us to understand this. Because I think sometimes people lose some joy because they don't have the right perspective. The very second that we make that decision to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we possess eternal life. It's guaranteed. And you can't lose that. It's guaranteed. In Luke chapter 16, verse 23 and 24, Jesus tells the parable about Lazarus and the rich man. And this is so sad. This is one of the reasons why I'm so passionate about sharing the gospel with lost souls. Jesus stated the rich man was in torment and hate. Said, I am an addict in this life. When I was studying, I was just trying to imagine, and we can't. What is it like being in Hades? And as the rich man said, that I am addict in this life. And the first thing that came to my mind is when our son Isaiah had a cranial reconstruction. He was 3 months old. They literally had to use a drill and a surgical saw to remove the top part of the skull. And when we were at the Children's Hospital in Indianapolis, there was no room in the end, and I guess what would be the recovery for people who had those kind of surgery. So he was staying in the burn for infants and young children. And we saw children who'd been scalded. I never forget. I know my wife didn't forget it either. I could. That there was one child that was in the burn unit. The child was all wrapped up. And the child had an accident. And the parents were told, the father was told to walk on the bed. We were in that area for a week. And saw that. That's the only first thing that came to mind. That's the agony of being burned. But that's as terrible as that is. No comparison. What the rich man said, I am agony in these flames. you accept Christ, if you go on a trial, and just imagine if the jurors who are in heaven might have been some people that didn't treat right and you were on earth. Woo! That would be scary, wouldn't it? We don't have to worry about that. The very second that we accept Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, we don't have to worry about judgment or trial. We're in there. Just like when you met your wife, when you do, the very second, I got it, man. She ain't going nowhere. You got it. We're in heaven. We don't have to worry about that. Wouldn't that be terrible for your whole life, the world, when you die? All that loop. Attorney in heaven for me. When I go on trial or judgment, they can make sure they say the right thing and cover the things I need to be right. I need to make sure I. We don't have to worry about that. It's guaranteed. And then lastly, the last promise that Jesus made in verse 24. He says that we cross over from death to life. We are all born in spiritual darkness. There's no way around it. It doesn't matter what kind of wealth you come from. It doesn't matter what side of town. It doesn't matter how nice looking you are or how nice looking we're not. Pity's not going to get you there either. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how great an athlete you are, how high your IQ is. None of that matters. We are all born in spiritual darkness. And Jesus is saying here in verse 24, when you accept me as your Lord and Savior, you cross over from spiritual death. And you are in spiritual, eternal life. And Jesus confirms this in John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. What a blessing it is. What a sense of peace knowing that Jesus makes these three promises to us. I always say this. I've always been, even before I was saved, I was always the glass that's three-fourths full. I've always had that positive attitude about things. And just to turn to someone, and all I need is for, even to this day, all I need is for someone to tell me, you can't do this. And I'm going to prove them wrong. I remember when I was in seminary, and I was taking Greek and Hebrew at the same time. And I was struck just the whole transition of moving away from home and going to school full time and taking those two foreign languages at the same time. And I was struggling. And I was under pressure. I uprooted my wife from our new home, and I could never go back and say, honey, I failed this class, and we're going to be here another 6 months. Couldn't do that. And I never forget, I told one of my professors that during the Christmas break, I said, I'm going to study every day. I'm going to study my Greek and Hebrew. And he said, people say that all the time. They never do it. Now, I don't know if he's saying that because that's what he felt. He was a very straight shooting guy. God bless him. Dr. Kim Bill, I love him. Or he was just saying to motivate me, but I took it as a personal challenge. And I got up during Christmas break every day at 6 o'clock in the morning. And I studied my Greek and Hebrew. And then I worked, helped the Lord with kids, just a little bit of time with the Lord. And I also read 3 Christian books during that break. And I'll never forget one of my brilliant professors, he taught Greek and Hebrew, he said, Dr. Marty Avery, brilliant man. And he said to me after the break, he said, I can tell. I felt so good. Man, he just feels so good that he realized that. But you know, we don't have to work that hard in heaven. Jesus already paid that price. Jesus declared the time was now for salvation through him. And once again, in verse 25, this verse is so important that Jesus emphasized it direct repetition. Amen, amen. Very truly, most certainly, once again, when Jesus says that, he has something very important to say. We need to focus on that. And Jesus said in verse 25, it's another declaration. Now, when I speak, I don't have the authority for it to be a declaration, a formal announcement, another slang term. I don't have enough juice to do that. So I just tell you something. But when Jesus says it, it's a declaration. He says, very truly, I declare to you, a time is coming, and has now come, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. And Jesus is saying that those of us, and at one time in our lives we were dead, those of us who are spiritually dead, you know, at one time, before we accepted Christ, we were alienated from God. It was like we were foreigners to him. You know, I can't imagine a worse state as a human being than to be alienated from God. To be foreign to God. To be spiritually dead for your entire life. You just think about it. I know some of them have family members or friends or co-workers who aren't saved. That's a burden, isn't it? And I pray every day for those people that I know who are not saved. And I pray for opportunities to share the gospel with people. And it's amazing how the Lord will just open up opportunities. God has worked in such incredible ways in my life to give me opportunities to share the gospel. One of my bosses asked me if I would do premarital counseling with her daughter and groom-to-be. And through that, they both prayed and said, Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior. It's amazing how God works. When Jesus is saying that in verse 25, a time is coming, and it's come now when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. When that happens, we are no longer alienated from God. We're no longer foreigners to him. But we can be called children of God. And I love to hear at the end of verse 25, where Jesus says, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God. He's saying that because he is declaring his glory. That's why if Jesus calls CNN and says, I want a press conference, the whole world will pay attention. Where if I call CNN, maybe glory in my grandkids, my children. Maybe some, I don't have that authority. I don't have the truth that Jesus has. But that's why he's saying here, I'm the Son of God. God has given me the authority to change the heart of children and women and men. And the Holy Spirit will convict them of their sin. I remember how the Holy Spirit convicted me of my sin. I knew God was missing. I was so lost. I didn't even understand how I was lost. I just knew that I was in spiritual darkness. And I knew something pertaining to God was missing in my life. I'm eternally grateful for that day. The greatest day in the history of my life. God gave Jesus the authority to save us from our sins. In closing, in John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. There's no other substitute. The only way that we can know for certain that we have eternal life is that we have to go through Jesus. And then the Apostle Paul said in Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you shall be saved. Believe God's word. Believe in God's Father. Believe in his Son. And you will possess for eternity. Eternal life. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the privilege to share the greatest story ever told about the greatest human being ever lived on this planet Earth. I thank you for that great privilege. Father, I pray that you have a passion for sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, I pray that whoever hears this message this morning, they will believe your word and have eternal life. Of course, in the mighty name of Jesus that we pray.
Would you please stand with us as we sing one more song? And, on that note, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, there's no better day than today to make that decision. And if that's something you're interested in doing, please come see Vaughn. Vicky's here. Don't leave without talking to someone. He is jealous for me, loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. He is jealous for me. His love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by the glory, affections are for me. So, how he loves us so, yeah. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. He's our prize, drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all safe. Heaven meets earth like an unforeseen guest. My heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Oh, he loves. how he loves us so. Oh.